Good morning. We have a minute to spare. That's kind of nice. But I just want to say a special welcome to each of you today for being here. It's summertime and you're never sure how many people are going to be here. People are on vacation, traveling and so on. But I'm so happy to see each of you this morning. And I pray that as we've gathered for worship, we will indeed be conscious of the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ, not just in our midst, but in your hearts as well. Some of us enjoyed a wonderful day at Jackson's Point yesterday as we attended the program that the kids presented from Junior Music Camp. And I want to tell you, they excelled. And it made me so, so very proud of each of them. I'm hoping that maybe in a Sunday or two, we might hear a little more about what took place during that week. And of course, we have to say a special thank you too to the faculty, some of whom were from our congregation. And I don't know, but I dare to say there are some sleep-deprived people in our midst this morning. So please choose when you fall asleep, okay? Anyway, here we are to worship and praise the Lord today. And our call to worship is taken from Psalm 84 and verse 11. It says this, "For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless." And we're going to be talking about walking with the Lord. So God bless you as we worship together. Now the worship team.
In Joshua 24, 14, 15, "So fear the Lord and serve him wholeheartedly. Put away forever idols your ancestors worshipped. Serve the Lord alone. But if you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. For me and my family, we will serve the Lord. The Lord is the only true God, that we should fear God and serve him only. God does not want to share the throne of his hearts with anything else." Please stand, join us and sing today.
Follow you today. I choose to give my yes to you today. I choose to hear your voice and live today. I choose to follow you. Serve you. As for me in my house, we will spend our lives on you today. I choose to follow. Today I choose.
Help us out.
To follow you. Today I choose to give my yes to you. Today I choose to hear your voice and live today. I choose to follow you. As for me, we will serve you. choose to follow you.
Please be seated.
Before you, and This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And I'm desperate for you.
Thank you, worship team, because the last two lines of that song, I'm desperate for you, I'm lost without you. And our first song this morning, that's found in the songbook, song 690, talks about trusting and obeying as we follow the Lord Jesus, as we follow the way that he has shown to us. So 690, the words are on the screen, when we walk with the Lord in the light of his word. Well, let's stand together as we sing. The band will help us. Now this song, this hymn, is not a modern-day hymn. It's been around for many, many, many years. In fact, the author, John Samus, wrote this back in the early 1800s, very early 1800s. The message is still the same today, isn't it? We must trust and obey We look at the third verse, and I'd like us to read it together. Not a burden we bear. Let's read together this third verse, and we'll sing verses 4 and 5. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil is doth richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a frown nor a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Together in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we'd come to you this morning with that thought ringing in our minds and in our hearts that we, as followers of you, as believers, that we will trust in you and that we will obey when you call and say to us what you want us to do. We thank you for your very presence with us. We thank you for this new day and that we are part of it. And thank you, Lord, this morning that we can come together as a family to worship you, for you are the creator, preserver, and governor of all things. And we honor you and praise you this morning for this time that we can spend together. Father, we come to you this morning and just pray that as we worship together, that we will be open to the leadings of your Spirit in our lives, that the sensitivity that you can give to us through your Spirit will cause us to think more of you and to really begin to trust and obey in what you have to say. So, Father, we commit this service to you. Pray your blessing upon Colonel Barbara, as she leads to us this morning and brings to us the word. Father, be with us, be with those who are not able to be here. There are many away traveling. Keep them safe on the roads. There are many that are not well, who are ill. We just commit them to you, Lord, and pray that your blessing will be upon them. Father, all things belong to you, and we give you thanks for everything. I'd like to pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Be seated, please.
I need to express thanks to those who will be participating today. And Major Cliff is always available to do anything I ask him to do, and I'm so appreciative of that fact. And there are so many others of you as well. that I appreciate. Our scripture reading this morning is taken from 1 John chapter 1, verses 5-9. This is the message we have heard and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him, yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live by the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word has no place in our lives. May God bless his word to our hearts today. Now, I'm wondering if I know we have some visitors, but I'm wondering if the visitors would like to stand. I see in front of me Majors Wilson and Lorraine Noble, who are visiting with their friends, Dennis and Fay, and the stories I could tell. We spent years together in the public relations department, and Lorraine came to be my guest at one of my women's camps in Newfoundland when we were stationed there, and so we go a long way back, and as I mentioned, I have lots of stories. I also see Ted's relatives from Brantford. Bless your hearts. It's nice to have you with us today. God bless you for being here. Is there anyone else? Liam, I say Liam. God bless you, my son. It's so good to see you. And may God continue to bless and strengthen you and give you good health. God bless you. Anyone else? Any other visitors? If you are, stand so we can welcome you. Anyway, let's welcome those we've mentioned. Now, the band is going to bring us their selection. And as I mentioned earlier, I'm always indebted when I'm asked to conduct a service for those. And I mean, we never, never question if a band will be here. We know we will always have a band. God bless you, Andrew, for arranging that. The worship team. Gil, you just got back from spending a week with all those kids up there. And here she is this morning gathering her team together. Thank you so much. At the piano and the keyboard, we will have a couple of more gals, I think, and so I'm grateful for those. And for our friends up in the heavenly realms, God bless you for keeping us on track. Julie, so many of you who have contributed to what this worship service will be today, God bless you. Now, God bless the band as we listen.
Thank you. Good morning. I was waiting for Barbara to welcome me back as a visitor. We're going to sing song 756, so if you, the words will be up on the screen. He walks with God who speaks to God in prayer and daily brings to him his daily care. Possessing inward peace, he truly knows a heart's refreshment and a soul's repose. I'm going to invite you to stand, and we're going to sing all three verses together with the help of the band.
Helpers I have. In fact, I'm thinking maybe come fall we might take it to the road. God bless each of you and thank you so much. Now, in order to give the band the chance to move down to join you folks in the congregation, we're going to sing a chorus that I haven't sung in many, many years. I hope you know it. We're talking about walking today. And this chorus says, in white, walking in white, he makes me worthy through the blood to walk with him in white. Sharon, perhaps you could just play through. Karen. Over here, Denise Knoll. Denise, it's so wonderful to see you. Only God knows what you've been through, but I'm sure you've been aware that you've been in the prayers of this congregation. And God is good, and you're looking good, and it's wonderful to see you today. God bless you. Now we have some special music this morning, and I'm delighted that we have a men's quartet. Now, once upon a time, I believe, we had them before. And I don't know where they disappeared, but they did. But they've come home, and here they are this morning. They're going to sing a very favorite song of mine, again, in the context of walking, He Leadeth Me. Let's welcome them, and we hope you'll stay. That was beautiful, guys. Thank you so much. And do stay around, and we'll hear from you again. Well, this morning, we're looking at walking with God, and our point of reference is Hebrews chapter 11. This 11th chapter of Hebrews has sometimes been referred to not as the Hall of Fame, but rather as the Hall of Faith. The star players of the Old Testament are there. Noah is mentioned. Abraham is there along with Isaac and Jacob. Moses receives a deservedly lengthy section. And included, of course, are the likes of Gideon and Samson, David and Samuel. Nearly all of the Old Testament heroes of the faith are listed, as indeed they should be. However, one of the first names on the list is some dude called Enoch. Now, who in the world is Enoch, anyway? Who is he? We don't know very much about him. Not to be disrespectful of this man in any way, but at first glance, we may wonder if he really belongs on the same page with people like David, Abraham, Noah, Moses, or any of the others that are listed. After all, we know that David had the reputation of being the greatest warrior and the most renowned king in the history of all of Israel. Abraham became known as the father of the faithful, the beginning of our heritage. Amidst many scoffers, Noah spent years building an ark, a massive accomplishment to be sure, in obedience to God. And then Moses led the people of Israel out of Egypt and through the desert for 40 years. Now, these men accomplished that which you and I probably would be proud to add to our resume. Each of these men is really what legends are all about. There is absolutely no doubt that they should most certainly be on the list of the heroes of faith. But Enoch, we wonder about Enoch. Consider this. Enoch's entire life is summed up in the span of just a few verses in Genesis chapter 5. Scripture doesn't give much background on him at all. We don't even know his profession. He might have been a stonemason. He might have been a woodcutter. He might have been a herdsman. He might have been a preacher. Well, there is one prophetic message from him recorded in the book of Jude, verses 14 and 15. However, we do know this about Enoch. He pleased God. Verse 5 of Hebrews 11 says, Enoch was commended as one who pleased God. He pleased God. Okay, so then how did he go about doing that? How did he please God? Well, that 24th verse of the same chapter, chapter 5, the last verse really in his life story, gives us the answer when it says, Enoch walked with God. Enoch walked with God. Friends, there is hope in that statement for you and for me. You see, I'm quite uncertain as to what I would do if the Lord asked me, for instance, to lead his people into battle, or to build an ark, or to rule over his people. These and the many other accomplishments of the heroes of faith seem completely overwhelming to me. I don't know the first thing about parting waters. The very thought of hand-to-hand combat with seasoned warriors scares the daylights out of me. You and I may very well be intimidated at the very idea of doing great and noble exploits in the name of Jesus. But listen, friends, like Enoch, we can walk with God. We can walk with God. For more than all the great accomplishments we will ever, ever achieve, walking with God is the very most important. When we walk with God, I believe it follows that we will walk like him. Now, a few years ago, when we were stationed in Vancouver, we met a family of Salvationists who were originally from a small fishing community in Newfoundland. They'd been away many, many years. And now people were leaving the community. That was in the years when the government had a program by which they moved people from smaller areas to larger communities. Some of you probably have seen pictures of houses being floated across the bay into another community. Well, this was happening in this little community as well. So our friend decided that after all the years of being away, parents were long gone, he decided he would want to go back once again just to visit the old homestead, see if there was anyone left that he knew, and to visit some of his familiar places. And so he went back. There were very few people left, but one morning he got up and decided he would walk down through the community, which didn't take long, 20 minutes maybe. And he came across a group of men sitting around a large boulder that was surrounded by grass, and there they sat. I mean, if there had been a Tim Hortons there, that's where they would have been, in a table in the corner where they would have spent a couple of hours or so. But there they sat, and as our friend passed by, he greeted them, good morning, and they greeted him in return. And just as he passed a few feet beyond them, one gentleman called out and said, "Are you related to Andrew Perry?" And our friend Eric replied, "Yes, he was my father." And the gentleman replied, "I knew it. You walk like your father. You walk like your father." Now, we have people in this congregation who walk like their parents. We do. You look sometime at Karen Allington and Katie. They walk the same, they do. They have precise little steps. Now, Katie's are quicker right now than Karen's, but they have precise little steps and they walk just so. Katie walks like her mom. Well, Eric Perry walked like his father. And I would say that more than all the other accomplishments we can achieve, it would be for someone to tell us that we walk with and like our Father God. Unfortunately, there are many things in life that would try and hinder us from walking faithfully with our God. Things like allowing ourselves to become overly busy or undisciplined or indifferent. Things that can, in time, wear away or erode our desire to walk with him. A few years ago, my late husband Howard and I were invited to return to our first Corps as a married couple to conduct Corps anniversary weekend. One evening while there, we walked along the shore of the river that ran by the back of the community, and we noticed several things that we had not noticed while we were stationed there. For instance, we saw several places where man-made piles of rocks jutted out into the water. They were not just small accumulations of stones, but rather large boulders forming blockades several feet out into the water. Also downstream from each of these collections of rocks, we noticed a place where the shoreline was considerably worn away. These stone blockades were not simply someone's personal pier for walking on. It was apparent that the waters of that river were wearing away large sections of the shoreline. The current of the river had pulled away rocks and soil from the edge. If left unchecked, those waters would have destroyed even more of the sections of the riverbank. As pointed out to us, the blockades were designed to keep any more of the shoreline from eroding. Friends, in our personal lives, we need blockades as well. We need to keep our spiritual lives and experiences from eroding. For you see, they can and they do. We need to make time to spend in the presence of our Lord, walking with Him on a daily basis. What then does it really mean to walk with God? It means that we need to keep Him at the very center of our lives in everything we do, everything we say, and even the things we think. When you come to the end of your life, I wonder what you would like people to remember about you. Perhaps you'd like to be remembered for some admirable qualities like kindness, love, generosity, knowledge, wisdom, or maybe your special skills and abilities, or the way you can relate so easily to other people. But as a believer, though, the greatest compliment, I repeat, you could ever receive would be the recognition that you walked with God. So then, back to this guy, Enoch. Genesis 5, 21 to 24, referred to him earlier, records that he was a man who walked with God right up until the time that the Lord took him to heaven. Also in the portion of scripture I mentioned earlier, the book of Jude, he's referred to as a righteous man who didn't have to face physical death because he was living a life pleasing to God. Now, Enoch lived at a time when, as it records in that fifth verse, the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was on evil continually. Conditions were so bad, you will recall, that the Lord regretted. He regretted that he had even made man. And as a result, there came a worldwide flood, which destroyed everything and everybody in it, except for Noah and his family. Today, do you think our world is much better, if any, than it was then? Isn't it very true that we too live in a sinful world in which many people are still walking in darkness? Their path is so spiritually dark that they are unable to see what lies before them, what dangers, obstacles are ahead. Yet many, if you talk to them, they will tell you they have no need of help and want nothing whatsoever to do with the only source of spiritual light, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I believe most of us, perhaps all of us, know the benefits of a daily physical walk. That's why so many people are doing it today. They are many. We are told that it strengthens our hearts, it lowers the risk of various kinds of diseases, it keeps our weight in check. They say it can help prevent dementia and osteoporosis. It tones our legs, our arms, our tummies. It boosts our vitamin D level, gives us energy, it makes us happy. Wow, quite a list. And there are many other benefits as well. And you know, friends, in like manner, our spiritual walk has a multiplicity of spiritual benefits. First of all, let's consider our walk with God by faith. That is the first thing we notice about Enoch's walk with God. He walked by faith. His faith was completely and continually in the God who created all things, in the God who promised there was a coming Redeemer. Our walk with God must be based on our faith that He is indeed walking with us and will continue to do so until we stand in His glorious presence. Secondly, Enoch's walk with God was one of perseverance. He lived in a godless time among godless people, yet it was possible for him to walk with God in spite of the culture in which he lived. Just think about it for a moment. Enoch lived in the days when the descendants of Cain, of which he was one, he was a son, were the dominant people, and they were not walking with God. Genesis 4 describes the line of Cain as violent, self-centered, and living in spiritual darkness. That is not to say, however, that the descendants of Cain were not intelligent, creative people. In many ways, they were industrious and cultured. They became founders of cattle raisers and sheep herders. They were founders of metalworks. They were founders of music and the making of musical instruments. Yet even though they were cultured, they were still walking in darkness and opposed to the ways of God. But Enoch, this man about whom we know so little, he persevered in his walk with God in spite of the ungodly environment in which he lived. Friends, you and I, like Enoch, are called to walk with God and to be lights in the darkness of our world, to be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Thirdly, Enoch walked with God with a God-given message. God gave him a message to share, and he was faithful in proclaiming that message. I've already referred to it, the book of Jude, verses 14 and 15. Now, the message he had to give was not a popular one. Indeed, it was a message of judgment. This is what it says. Listen. See, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones to judge everyone and to convict on the ungodly of all the ungodly acts they have done in an ungodly way and all the harsh words sinners have spoken against him. However, Enoch's walk with God enabled him to be bold in proclaiming God's message to an ungodly society. Our walk with God should give us the courage and the boldness to proclaim God's message, not in a rude or arrogant way, no, but in a simple way of witnessing to who the Lord is and what he has done in our lives, God's message to our generation in our world. Finally, the end of Enoch's walk. Regarding the end of Enoch's life, this is what is recorded in Hebrews 11 and 5. He was not found, for God took him. This indicates that he did not die physically, but rather was translated into heaven by the power of God. Now, I'm sure there are many very deep theological explanations as to why it happened like it did. However, in my simple faith, I like the story of the little girl who in Sunday school was listening to the story of Enoch, who then, the teacher then asked, does anyone have any idea why God took him to heaven like that? This little girl raised her hand and said, I think I know the answer. God and Enoch took many long walks together every day. One day they were walking for so long that it was getting dark, so God said to Enoch, let me take you to my home, for your home now is too far away. Then God took him home with him, and he lived with him forever. Simple, simple, but yet so very sublime. Walking with God, friends, for you and for me, is like saying at the beginning of each day, Holy Spirit, this day is your day. Use it and me as you see fit. It is like praying throughout the day, Heavenly Father, continue to direct my choices and my decisions. Use me to glorify Jesus. It means bringing every decision every opportunity, every temptation, every desire to him, asking for his direction and his power. You see, walking in the Spirit is dynamic, active obedience. It is not merely enough to believe in and assume that there is a God. No. We need to know him in a personal way and to walk with him on a daily basis. It was Einstein who once said, "Certainly there is a God. Any man who doesn't believe in a cosmic figure is a fool." But we can never know him. But we can never know him. Brilliant as Einstein was, he was wrong. He was wrong. We can know God, and we can know him in a most intimate way. In fact, in order to know God as did Enoch, in order to live a life pleasing to him, we must believe that he is a personable, knowledgeable, loving, caring, moral, and responds graciously to those who seek him. Both the Old and New Testaments are filled with teachings that there is without a doubt a God whom we can know. Sorry, Mr. Einstein, but you were wrong. The Lord's greatest desire is that we find him, we know him personally, and we walk with him in and by faith. What exactly then is God asking of us today? But to do good things, to love his mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. We're going to turn to song number 553, if you use your songbook, 553. Be still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here. And I believe that. 566, sorry. No, it's not that either. Some numbers got changed around some way, but that's the song we're singing anyway. Be still for the presence of the Lord. The Holy One is here. Come bow before him now with reverence and fear. In him no sin is found. We stand on holy ground. And that's where we are today, on holy ground. This sanctuary, which has been dedicated to the glory of God, is a holy place. Doesn't matter about the renovations that are going on. We are standing on holy ground. Be still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here. And I just want to remind you, even though I know you don't need reminding, this place of prayer is here. A place where God's people can gather in his name and through his promise. I know he meets you right where you're sitting this morning. I know that. But there's something wonderful about the fact that we can get up from where we're sitting and we can bow at this place of prayer and know that he meets us there. He does. And no matter what our situation in life might happen to be, and they are many and varied, but we all have them. We all have needs of one kind or another. And so, in the stillness of this moment, I invite you to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to your heart. I don't know what he's telling you. I don't know what he's revealing to you. I don't know what he's telling you ought to do, but you know. And God knows his will for your life. So God bless you. Allow Spirit to direct you as we sing together. The presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here.
Be still, the presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here.
just the chorus, move Holy Spirit, move in my life, move Holy Spirit, make me like Christ. In my walk, in the things I say, the things I do, my reaction to other people, make me like you. Move Holy Spirit, move in my life. God bless you, and may he do just that in your life. He will, for sure. Now, as the band returns to the platform for our final song, we're going to sing the chorus, I Pledge Allegiance to the Lamb. And I hope that's your experience. Let it be our testimony. Let it be your determination. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb. With all my heart, with all I am, I will seek to honor his command. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb. Even if you're the only one in your family, God bless you. Pledge allegiance today. I'm going to invite you to stand as we sing the chorus together. Now then, our closing song is number 441 in your songbook, and I just want to say thank you to the groups who've sung today and to the band for taking hold of the theme of this meeting. And I hope you've noticed, and even the offertory, thank you, Sharon, all featured on our walk with God. And this last song says, there's a path that's sometimes thorny, and sometimes it is. There's a narrow way and straight. It is called the path of duty, and it leads to heaven's gate. While we tread this path of duty, we will find our needs supplied from the river of God's mercy that is flowing close beside. First verse together, Madly.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, we rejoice today in your greatness and your power, your gentleness and love, your mercy and your grace. May we go forth into this coming week to honor you in our thoughts and actions, and to serve you as we walk humbly with our God. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.